Finance Minister Katy Gallagher has broken her silence, acknowledging she did have prior knowledge of some details of the Brittany Higgins rape allegation, but denying she misled Parliament.
I was responding to an assertion that was being made by the Minister Reynolds at the time that we had known about this for weeks and had made a decision to weaponise it. That is not true. It was never true.
The Labor government has tried to switch the focus to former Prime Minister Scott Morrison over a review he ordered into how the scandal was handled. The findings from that review have never been released.
Let's bring in federal politics reporter Rhys D'Alessandro in Canberra. Rhys, good morning, Labor trying to switch the focus to Scott Morrison.
Yeah, that's right, Clint. With an upcoming sitting week that commences on Tuesday, it was probably a necessity Katy Gallagher decide to face the music to push back against these accusations. She and other senior Labor figures coordinated with Brittany Higgins and her partner David Shiraz before Ms Higgins went public with her allegations of rape against Bruce Lerman. We should point out their allegations Bruce Lerman has always denied. Now, the issue here is Senator Gallagher told a Senate hearing in 2021 after Ms Higgins went public she had no prior knowledge of the incident. Earlier this week, text messages between her and Ms Higgins' partner David Shiraz were leaked. Text message between Higgins and David Shiraz were leaked, including some mentioning Katy Gallagher. That led to that accusation that she did in fact have prior knowledge and that she may have misled Parliament. That's an accusation Katy Gallagher denied yesterday. Take a listen.
No, I did not mislead the Parliament. I was responding to an assertion that was being made by the Minister Reynolds at the time that we had known about this for weeks and had made a decision to weaponise it. That is not true. It was never true.
Who knew what and when is a question that's now haunted both sides of politics since these allegations emerged. It's worth noting the Prime Minister at the time was Scott Morrison. There were questions around who in his office knew. He requested a review be conducted, but it was paused and its findings have never been released. Nevertheless, the opposition says it's going to continue to prosecute this issue when Parliament returns on Tuesday.
Clint? Rhys D'Alessandro in Canberra, thank you.
Let's bring in Chief Political Correspondent for the Saturday Paper, Karen Middleton from Canberra. Good morning to you, Karen. This seems like a pretty nuanced argument. What exactly is Katy Gallagher saying?
Well, yes, it is nuanced, guys. She's saying that she didn't mislead Parliament because she was responding to a suggestion that she was planning to weaponise this, and she says that's what was wrong. Now, the problem here is that what she actually said in that Senate committee, which has the same status as if she said it in Parliament, was no one knew anything. And it's quite clear she did know at least something, and that's where the problem's going to lie for her.
So, given that, Karen, the PM denies Gallagher actually misled Parliament, but there are calls now for her to step down. How will it end?
Well, this is the question. I don't think we know yet. It's going to depend how it goes in Parliament this week. The government is clearly digging in, the Prime Minister included. The opposition is clearly going to go for Katy Gallagher and try and make as much out of this as it can. And, of course, the point you've got to make here is that now the Liberals are doing exactly what they accused Labor of doing, which is weaponising a rape allegation.
And let's not forget where this all started, which was, of course, with a young woman making an allegation of rape inside Parliament House. Do you think the public has the stomach to keep listening to politicians arguing over the minutiae of this?
Well, you're right. There's two things here, isn't there? There's the legal question, and of course Bruce Lerman was charged, the trial was dropped, he's not had any findings against him, and there's the political question, and we're now finding that it's in the political domain. So the political questions are being asked, but there's at least a couple of other big questions that are at least as important, and that is how these text messages came to be in the public domain at all. They were part of evidence briefs that went to a limited number of parties in that criminal trial. They weren't tendered in evidence because they were considered not legally relevant, but somebody somewhere in there has decided they are politically relevant and that they're going to be put in the public domain now. And what we don't know and we should know is who and why.
Hey Karen, there's also been plenty of questions over exactly what Senator Penny Wong knew. Is she still feeling heat?
She's saying that she knew a little bit, but not a lot. Now, I think the pressure on her will be somewhat less than on Katy Gallagher because it was Katy Gallagher who made that definitive statement. But I expect the coalition will go for both of them when Parliament resumes.
It is going to be a busy 2 weeks coming up in Canberra. Karen Middleton from the Saturday Paper, thanks for your time this morning. Welcome back to Weekend Today. Finance Minister Katy Gallagher has broken her silence over rape allegations made by former Liberal staffer Brittany Higgins, denying that she misled Parliament over when she knew of that issue. So to discuss this, let's bring in today's talkers, Nationals leader David Littleproud and 2GB's Clinton Maynard. Good morning to you both. David, Senator Gallagher says she has been clear and honest about things. Are you happy with her response?
Well, let's get back to first principles on this. Whenever is it okay for politicians to weaponise criminal proceedings and criminal investigations? No questions should have been asked in Parliament. There was an investigation underway and then subsequent charges were laid. We shouldn't be weaponising criminal proceedings. It's actually beholden on us as political leaders to create the environment for the police and the courts to be able to investigate and then to prosecute appropriately. The fact that it even ended up in Parliament is a reflection on Katy Gallagher, the Prime Minister, Tanya Plibersek and Penny Wong, which should have been kept out of the Parliament. But I think not only are there questions for Katy Gallagher to answer around what she knew when, but I think the government needs to be transparent with the Australian people. There's allegedly $2 to $3 million in compensation that was paid to Ms Higgins. I think it's now, in light of even what the Chief of Staff has come out and stated, is that she followed the procedures of the Department of Finance, who are in charge of human resources in the Parliament House. Then if all the proceedings that she undertook were to the standard, why did the Australian people fork out $2 to $3 million allegedly? I think those are questions that Katy Gallagher and Anthony Albanese need to answer. The Australian people deserve those answers. But I think it's a big lesson for us all that politics should stay away from criminal proceedings, and as political leaders, we should take that lead and should never weaponise this in the Australian Parliament, not only in the past, but even into the future.
Clinton, has this issue been weaponised, and how do you think this is going to play out politically?
I think she's going to be under massive pressure, Jane, in Parliament this week, and I think Anthony Albanese will be under that pressure as well. Based on the feedback I had on my radio program this weekend, people are actually angry and confused about this. I don't think her explanation yesterday is good enough. Now, she said before the parliamentary estimates hearing last year that she had no prior knowledge. Penny Wong said the same thing. But yesterday she said, well, she did have information. Well, what's the difference between information and knowledge? It would seem to me that information and knowledge are actually the same thing. So that's her explanation for not misleading Parliament. Then we have the text messages between David Shiraz and Brittany. Something doesn't add up, and people can see through that.
It is a very nuanced argument, and one we're going to be, I think, delving into for some time to come. Let's move on to another issue now. Australian teenagers, they can earn super, they can pay tax, they can drive a car, so why can't they vote? This is the question the Make It 16 campaign will be asking when it launches in Canberra this week, with the goal to convince politicians to lower the voting age to 16. What do you think, David? Are you on board with this?
Oh, look, I'm all for young people to get involved in the political process and our democracy even further, but I think they should wait until they have to pay for their ideology. And that means when they're living away from home, they have to pay for a mortgage, they have to pay electricity and rates. I think it's great that they want to be involved, but I think the legal age of an adult in this country is 18. We should leave it there, because if you want to vote, you've got to be able to pay for the ideology in which you hold. And I think, unfortunately, sometimes they...
I was going to say, David, people are living at home till they're 30 because they can't afford to buy or even rent a house in this country. Surely we should give them the chance to vote at 16 so they can have some say in how things are done.
My kids will be living at home until they're 40, so they won't ever be voting. I don't think they should, unless we want a lot more MPs from the Smoke More Dope Party elected to Parliament.
Oh, come on.
If it's going to happen, it can't be compulsory, because there are so many young people and adults as well who don't have the maturity or the interest in current affairs and current events, unless they have some special maturity testing and IQ testing, and they have to pass that to then be able to vote.
David, some 16-year-olds have more sense than adults, don't they?
Look, I don't think that they've had the worldly or life experiences as those that are actually in the workforce permanently and out there having to make their own way without the comfort of home. And I get there's people at home till 40, but you haven't formed the opinions predicated on life experience of having to pay for it. And I think even voluntary voting, I'm not in favour of. Otherwise, you end up like the Americans, where you mobilise a base and you get extremes coming out to vote rather than the sensible centre of Australians, which I think Australians are. We're fair-minded people. I think it's important. You have a responsibility to vote. You should actually go and do it. That's one of the only commitments of living in a democracy that you should live up to.
I'm alone on this one. I would have loved voting when I was 16, but I'm a nerd.